participating was in a Puma powder, and two of the participants that were most active were these young gentlemen from Uruguay, Daniel Francis and Augustine. Augustine ended up being one of the winners, and Daniel would have been one of the winners, but he got disqualified. And the reason why he got disqualified was because he got elected to the Sugar Lab board during the middle of the contest, and that made him ineligible to win.
Wow.
But the reason why I want to bring this up is because when we first started doing sugar, we made sugar we were very deliberate in our choice to make sugar be free software libre. And we did that for a number of different reasons, some of them sort of the usual reasons. We were a small team and we needed to reach out and have a community develop around the project, and free software certainly is the right way to do that. I personally think that free software is a better model for software development in general. I think that there's some ethical reasons for using free software in a project like this. Many, many different reasons. But the most important reason in my mind was that because this is a project about education, about learning, I didn't want to give the end users a black box. I wanted to give the end users something that they could look at and study and modify and change. And because I wanted them to use not just the tool, but the opportunity to understand the tool as part of their learning experience. And so this was sort of, glorious, high-minded talk. And all it was talk. And so I went several times in the first few years of Sugar to the Libra Planet Conference and talked about Sugar and our motivations. And at the end of my talk, each time I said that I was asked, okay, I understand all that, but does it work? Is it really happening that way? Are your end users actually invested in the principles of free software, or are they just using the code? And I had no evidence that it was working for the first couple of years. For the first couple of years, all the patches were being submitted by a team of software developers, not by any sugar users. And suddenly, we started to get a few sugar activities submitted from end users. And then suddenly we started to get a few patches to Sugar submitted by end users. And it grew and grew and grew and grew and grew, so that now more than 10% of the Sugar activities have been written by kids.
Wow.
And when I say kids, I'm talking 12-year-olds. And 30% of the Sugar activities are maintained by kids. And we have now a number of kids who grew up with Sugar who are making significant patches to the core Sugar package. And Daniel and Augustine being examples of that. The thing that made their work stand out in the Google Coded project was they didn't just work on activities, they worked on core Sugar, and they made significant contributions during the month of the contest. Augustine made a series of patches that enable you to put an image on your home screen now in the background. And I don't know if you've played with that patch at all, but it's really nice.
I think
the idea that it allows.
Sorry, go ahead.
It's a nice enhancement. It's a really nice enhancement to Sugar because it's right at our sweet spot, which is personal expression. Allowing the kids to be expressive. And so the fact that one of our users, a Sugar user, enhanced Sugar that way is just really, it's great. Daniel did something a little bit more subtle, but I think actually very spot on in terms of our pedagogical model, and that is he made it so that you can have multiple home views. So the idea is you can have a home view at home and a home view at school. And the reason why that becomes important is that in a lot of school situations, the teacher or the structure of school, the formality of school, restricts the expression of the children. And a lot of, actually, for example, we had this problem in Peru. In Peru, they wanted to limit the number of activities on the laptop because they didn't want to clutter the classroom full of things. So Daniel, by enabling the sugar user to have their own collection of activities, their own home outside of their home and school, which is so regimented, enables the end user to be much more expressive user of sugar. Unleashes the opportunity for some risk-taking by our end users. Because what it all boils down to, and actually, so last summer I was in India, I was in Assam. I was visiting the IIT in Assam. And I met a lot of students. And unquestionably, these students are incredibly bright, incredibly qualified, incredibly learned. But they're also incredibly repressed. And it was actually, to me, quite depressing hearing their stories. Because they're in a situation which is the keep your head down style of learning. They're in a situation where they are rewarded for doing well in their exams and they're punished for making mistakes. And if you think about it, a carrot and stick model is about the worst model you can imagine if you want to grow a generation of entrepreneurs. Because a carrot and stick model punishes risk-taking. It discourages risk-taking. So these students, as bright as they are, as talented as they are in a structure that's discouraging them from taking any kind of intellectual risk. And so it was, as much as I enjoy meeting the individual students, the situation they were in was really disheartening. And we know from, there's a wealth of literature, a wealth of scientific literature that demonstrates that carrots and sticks are a poor motivator. And that the real motivation, what truly motivates us as humans, are three things. One is autonomy. That we really do better when we have some degree of freedom to express ourselves. The second is a sense of mastery. That we strive to master our circumstances. And thirdly is a sense of purpose. If we have a clear goal and we embrace that goal, then we're really motivated. So with sugar, and in particular, I think because of sugar's connection to free software, we're providing our end users autonomy, an opportunity to become a master, and because it's open, because it's free, we can let them choose whatever sense of purpose they want. So I think that this whole thing comes back around to not just to technology, but also to pedagogy.
Yeah.
So that's the good news, and I think we've got a lot of evidence that it works. Let me just tell one more story. There's a program at National University of Asuncion in Paraguay. I don't know how many of you, some of you I think know Tincha.
Yeah.
Martin Avente.
Yeah.
Martin is teaching a sugar class at the university. And so his students were all working on their projects, and they had a Git repository. And all of a sudden, Martin noticed that there was somebody coming in from Uruguay, because he could tell from the IP address that it was an Uruguay IP address. There was somebody coming in and helping all the students with their projects. And Martin got a little curious, who is this person that's coming in and helping all my students? Turns out it was a 12-year-old from Uruguay, a sugar hacker, who was coming in and helping all these university students with their projects.
Wow.
So, to me, they're sort of, I think the numbers and the examples demonstrate that we've got a model that really can engage and really motivate and drive learners to a whole other level. And the Sugar Project really is being co-opted and taken over, and rightfully so, by the sugar users and the sugar community. And I think that was my goal from the very beginning. I'm lazy, This way, you know, the users do it, I don't have to. I can just work on the patches I feel like. But, you know, so that's the good news. Now, let me tell you the bad news. Okay. The bad news, and it's bad news everywhere, and in fact, I think it's particularly bad news in India. The bad news is I'll express in one word, tablets. Now, let me tell you my problem with tablets. My problem with tablets, I've got all sorts of problems with tablets as a hardware device, but those aren't my real problem. I mean, I think that everybody should be writing and writing both text and writing code, and to take away a keyboard, I think, is to make that a much more difficult process. I mean, we'll eventually have good tools on tablets for programming and for writing, but right now they're anything but as adequate as having a keyboard. So, but I can get over that. That will change, we'll make improvements, and Apple eventually will be a reasonable device for production and construction, not just consumption. Right now, it's really a device for consumption. And any kind of production of content on a tablet is impaired. It's much more difficult. And that's why, as you pan the camera around the room, I saw a lot of machines that had keyboards attached.
Yeah.
I think that's not just a coincidence. I think that's because keyboards are more efficient for being expressive with text. And since a lot of the expression that we're building, especially when we're programming, is expression with text, I think it's critical to have a keyboard. But again, let me put that aside. The reason I have a problem with tablets is a cultural one. Because a tablet is on track as part of the extension of phone culture, not computing culture. And phone culture, unlike computing culture, is a culture of consumption. It's a culture of consuming services, services that come from somewhere else. And it's you know, using the cloud, it's using whatever the local telephone company wants to give you to use. It's computing in service of reliance as opposed to computing in service of the end user. And so I understand the economic models, I understand the incentive by large corporations to have a tablet solution. It's easy to maintain, it's cheap, it's easy to distribute, but it's contrary to the goals of learning. Because the goals of learning are such that we want our end users to be able to take risks, to be able to express themselves, to be able to understand what it means to change something, to make a mistake, to shape something, to meet their needs, to pursue their own personal goals. All these things that you can do in sugar, you can't do in the world of a tablet. Or if you can do it in the world of a tablet, it's enormously difficult. Nobody writes code on a tablet for their tablet. They write little toy programs on their tablets, but they don't actually use their tablet to do the real software engineering. Because they can't. Because the tools aren't there. The tools are elsewhere. The tools are on their computers. And so by deciding that the solution is a tablet, for very narrow, short-term economic reasons, I think we're really taking a big, big step backwards in terms of thinking about technology and learning, and thinking about kinds of opportunities we're giving kids. So, you know, we're working on HTML5 support, we're working on a lot of things to make it so that sugar and the world of tablets, my battery's running out. I'm going to walk over to where I've got an outlet.
Sure.
But you'll get a tour of my house.
Sure.
The idea that, you know, that we can move some of the, you know, sugar-like features to a tablet world, you know, we're going to do that, but we have no choice because we want to go wherever kids are. And so we'll strive to do that. But nonetheless, the whole culture around tablets and tablet-like implementations is just fundamentally flawed. But how I realize, I thought I had my laptop charged. because I had it plugged in, but the plug wasn't plugged into the wall. That's my battery ran out. So let me just fix that.
Sure.
Put it in the stand, because my laptop is sitting plugged in all the way. Much better. Okay. So my word of not so much a word of warning, but my I want to urge all of you to really be vigilant about this transition of the technology base, to make sure that as the world moves to tablets, as it's inevitably going to do, at least in the short term, that we remain vigilant about making sure that the software remains open. Not just open in terms of the license, but also open in terms of providing an opportunity to actually exploit that license to do things, to make changes. I think the thing that makes me most the most pleased about how Sugar has evolved is that we've made it easier and easier and easier for our end users to take advantage of the freedom the license gives them. Most free software projects give you a license, but they don't give you the means to exercise that license. And Sugar is really diligent about giving you the means as well as the license to make change. And the world of the tablet is removing those means. And we've really got to be diligent about combating against that. Anyway, I wanted to, that's sort of what's been on my mind of late.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to just tell you that, and then maybe we can just have a chat or a discussion.
Sure.
What kinds of things are you guys going to be working on over the weekend?
So I guess one of the aims is to get a basic grasp on Sugar. We have a Sugar emulator running inside a virtual machine. Many of the people here have Linux machines, so they have Sugar running natively. We also actually have one of the school servers, which is under development through Adam and others in Toronto and elsewhere. So I have that XSE running. Hopefully we'll get a chance to hack on that as well. But mostly it's to get familiar with the development platform.
Excuse me.
Sure, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, so.
I can hear you, yeah. You were saying, last thing I heard you say was similar. Yeah.
No. I would be very happy if we. If by tomorrow we had people who are able to work at a Sugar environment and maybe fix a few bugs or develop some cool features, maybe you have some ideas with Total Art. We can be on IRC later on as well. Daniel, Gonzalo, Manuel will be online and helping us as well.
Sure. Yeah, I'll be on. Right, so I'll be online all day, and so I can be there to answer questions or help in any way. There are a lot of different things. I could throw out ideas of things to hack on, but I think it's better a project that you're interested in doing, and then we can help you get going. Okay, there's the expression, love is a better master. So you should be working on something you really love,
yeah.
As opposed to working on something we tell you to do.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll go around the room over the next couple of
months. Yeah, I've got a lot of projects going, but G-stream hackers in the room?
G-streamer? Anyone? G-streamer audio video?
You lose,
No. We just went around the room and there's nobody who knows G-Streamer here. I used to know it once upon a time, but I don't think I know it anymore. Yeah. Oh, damn it. Crap.
Is it a torrent in the
channel?
Torrent, people.